Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. I'm Dave Plummer, a retired operating systems engineer from Microsoft going back to the mid-90s, and today we're going back a lot further than that to take a look at some truly ancient iron that I've recently just acquired. Now, I've been coding since the 80s, and so I've got a soft spot for some of the really early machines. I've even got a little museum set up in my office where you can find an Amiga, a Commodore 64 and 128, a VT220, a TRS-80, and a bunch of pets. This is my green pet. And this is my white pet. And this is my custom amber pet. As you start to go back to times even before I got started, we find machines like my Kim 1 stack and the MSI replica. And yet, for all this hardware, there's one thing that's sorely missing, and that would be the OG of desktop computers, the one and only true original, the Altair 8800. That's the computer that would prompt Gates and Allen to start writing their basic interpreter that would later spread to almost all desktop computers of the day. In fact, it really all started with the January 1975 issue of Popular Electronics magazine. Unlike most everything that had come to pass before, the Altair was a complete computer, including all of the components, ready to assemble in a professional package. And they'd soon switch to selling fully assembled units, lowering the barrier to entry even further. News of the Altair's debut fairly rocked the electronics world, which had been eagerly waiting for a moment just like this.
No way!
But it took until the new Intel 8080 chip came along before it was really practical. Paul Allen had been browsing the magazines at a newsstand called Out of Town in Harvard Square when he saw the Popular Electronics cover. He bought a copy of the magazine and ran eagerly to show it to his friend Bill Gates. Bill's initial reaction was excitement mixed with fear. Excitement over the possibilities that the Altair would open up, but fear that others had already begun work on those opportunities and that they would have a head start. He did not want to be left behind.
You know, good news, bad news. Here was someone making a computer around this chip in exactly the way that Paul had talked to me, and you know, we thought about what kind of software could be done for it, and it was happening without us.
It was time to get serious, and it would lead to Bill dropping out of Harvard to chase their joint dream full-time. For all of its potential, the Altair was incredibly rudimentary. There was no monitor, there was no keyboard.
There was really nothing you could do with it. I mean, there's no teletype hookup in the early days. There's no software for it.
Ostensibly, you could connect a teletype or a terminal to it, but there was no operating system or interpreter to interact with, even if you did so. The only means of entering code and data was through a set of switches on the front panel.
Use them here. And key things into this front panel, and you know, maybe do a little program that does things in the lights.
You could enter individual instructions and data bytes in binary using those switches, but as you can imagine, that was very slow going. Your best bet was to load code in from paper tape, but even then, you would have to toggle in the bootloader code that knew how to read the paper tape in the first place.
The bootstrap loader, that is the thing you have to key in to make this computer smart enough to know to go get data off the teletype to read it into memory.
Gates wanted to write a basic interpreter for the Altair that would transform it from just an electronics kit for hobbyists into a much more useful and, for its day, easy-to-use machine. They didn't have an actual Altair and likely wouldn't be getting access to one in the near future, so they would have to make do somehow else. To that end, Paul Allen updated the simulator he already had for the 8008 chip to be able to handle the new 8080 chip. He'd perhaps adapted it from the Interp 8008 simulator that shipped with the PDP-10, but regardless, he now modified it to support the new 8080 chip. With access to the simulator, they could now start writing their version of BASIC for the Altair.
Of course, the simulator, it's very slow because you go through lots of instructions to a single instruction. So actually, the real machine, even though it's such a simple little microprocessor, was faster than our PDP-10 simulator.
Microsoft BASIC is, to be sure, pretty clever internally. The floating point code alone sets it apart from most other BASICs of the time, and that part was written by a Harvard friend named Monty Davidoff. He based his floating point code loosely on how the focal interpreter did it on the PDP-10. Where Bill got his ideas for the way BASIC works, I don't actually know. I suppose it could have all been from first principles, I suppose, but I always assumed they would have been familiar with the interpreters available for the PDP-10 at Harvard and the one that they had access to back in high school. Bill had spent a good deal of his time during his stint at Computer Center Corporation studying existing code, but which interpreters he was inspired by is a question I'd love to ask him someday. Bill reached out to MITS, or MITS, the company that made the Altair. They had a lot of kooks and dreamers calling them up out of sheer excitement over the release of the Altair, and they had to sort the possibles from the probables.
And they thought that was interesting. They called back and said, well, you're serious. You know, we have a lot of strange people calling us, because this article received immense interest.
Something about Bill convinced their chief, Ed Roberts, that he was the real deal. And long story short, a deal was struck whereby Microsoft would produce the official BASIC interpreter for the Altair. The Altair thus begat BASIC, which begat DOS, which in turn begat Windows. So in a biblical sense, it all goes back to that popular electronics cover and the Altair.
It became, for the first generation of PCs, the thing that unlocked the power that was there, because although some people did machine language programming, 90% of what got done was done in BASIC, and 90% of that was Microsoft BASIC.
Now, the problem with Altairs today, of course, is that they're fairly rare and quite expensive when you do find them. If you do manage to stumble across an auction for one, the odds of it being in working order still today are very slim. Most of them have been hacked on pretty extensively and modified as well. I set a search alert on eBay and went through a dozen or so prior completed auctions to see what recent prices had been like. They ranged anywhere from about $2,000 for a basket case up to about $10,000 for a lower serial number unit from overseas. I needed to be much closer to the low end of that, but I still wanted one in good shape, which meant I was going to be picky. And that meant I wouldn't be getting one in a hurry. Good condition, cheap, or get it in a hurry. Pick any two. Within a year or so, however, I was able to snipe a nice original Altair 8800 that was in working condition. Or at least according to the seller, it powered on and the lights worked, and so you could toggle things in with the switches, and that's all that really mattered to me. If it worked that far, any remaining problems would likely be fairly simple to fix. I completed the transaction, and about a week later, a box showed up my door sealed with that colorful eBay shipping tape. When I unpacked the Altair, it seemed to have survived shipping and so was well packed, and so I carefully set it up and flipped the power switch. And that's where we came in.
Go! Go! Go!
Dead as a doornail. Actually, the fan came on, so I knew at least the switch was working, but nothing on the front panel worked at all. I got back in touch with the seller, who sent me a video of it running to prove that it had worked at some point in the past, but that didn't really help me any now. He didn't have any ideas or theories to share with me, so I was sort of on my own. If I took him at his word, it had most likely happened in shipping somehow. Now, I'm not an electronics guru, not by a long shot. But I'm learning. I've been watching a lot of Adrian's Digital Basement, and I've been slowly troubleshooting as much of my own electronics as I can as a learning tool. Sometimes I get in over my head, and I have to rely on folks like David from Microsoft or Neil from the Shadowtron blog channel. They're both skilled techs, and both have done a lot of repairs for the channels of late, but I wanted to see if I could fix this one myself before I completely wore out my welcome with them. The first thing I did was to break out the manual, which was very handily included as one of about five binders of documentation that came with the machine in the box. The power supply diagram indicated that there's a screw terminal connector in the back of the machine that should feature plus and minus 16 volts and then two 8-volt feeds. The way these older machines worked was to distribute unregulated higher voltages directly off the big linear power supply, like 8 volts and 16 volts, to the individual boards in the machine via the card slots. It'd be like today if your PC power supply provided 16 volts to everything over the bus, and then your video card was responsible for making its own 12 volts somehow. But it also means that every card has to duplicate the circuitry needed to regulate from 16 down to 12. On the Altair, for example, your RAM board would contain at least a 12 volt and a 5 volt regulator, perhaps a minus 12 volt system, and it would regulate the incoming 16 volt and 8 volts down to those levels. That also means it has to shed the excess power as heat, and so it's not the most efficient way of doing things, but it works. I checked the screw terminal connector at the back of the machine again to confirm that the voltages were all present, but one was indeed missing. Only one of the 8-volt legs was hot, and the other one was completely dead. There's supposed to be two, one for the motherboard and one for the front panel, and my front panel supply seemed mostly inert. It didn't seem to have a dead short in it, though, so I took an old hot-rodding approach that probably isn't appropriate for sensitive electronics, but I hot-wired it. I simply, first with a fuse in line, ran a jumper from the working 8-volt side to the non-working 8-volt side, and as mentioned, the two 8-volt feeds serve different purposes. A higher amperage 8-volt circuit feeds the cards through the bus, and a lower amperage 8-volt circuit feeds the front panel switches and LEDs. Since it was the low-amp circuit that I was missing, I figured the high-amp side could bear the extra load for a few seconds at least. So with my jumper in place, I flipped the power switch, and sure enough, lights, camera, action, and it came alive. I quickly turned it back off as I was afraid of overloading the working 8-volt side. It might even run like that forever, for all I knew, but it certainly wasn't designed to work that way, and if they went to the trouble of an extra transformer for the front panel, I'm sure there was a good reason to do so. I just had to figure out why it wasn't working in stock form. My friend Kai from Microsoft mentioned that this Altair has the base power supply, intended at most for a couple of extra cards on the bus, but my machine has been expanded with half a dozen cards like RAM and serial and so on. The power situation might already be on the ragged edge of acceptable, and so there's no need to push it any further. Any shot I had at being able to diagnose the power supply was highly compromised by the fact that it's very hard to get to the power board. There are transformers mounted above it, and the backside of its PCB is mounted nearly flush against the flat steel chassis, so test points and so on are hard to establish, and you can't even see the PCB traces at all. Another factor at play was that it was pretty gross in there, covered with 40 years of dust and skin flakes and whatever else accumulates in a chassis with a big fan that has no filter. I decided to pull the power transformers and board and everything else out of the machine, clean it up, and see if I could get it working on the bench. If nothing else, it'd be a lot easier to diagnose and repair a part on the bench than all crammed inside the machine. And so, one by one, I removed each of the three transformers, and then finally, the power PCB itself. I had to detach about a dozen wires from the screw terminal connector, and so I carefully labeled each one with a tape tag indicating which terminal had been removed from. Photos and notes could be helpful too, but in most of the wiring in this machine is black and it's not color-coded, and so tags are likely a safer way to go. Now, I waited until my wife wasn't home, and then I took the power supply into the house so I could clean it in the big laundry sink. I kept claws under at all times so that the PCB didn't scratch the sink, and I started by misting everything with a light foaming cleaner. I honestly don't know how much water electronics are capable of temporarily tolerating, but I was confident that I didn't want to get the transformers wet. I knew that much. I gave the board a gentle sponge bath and then dried things off with a microfiber towel. Figuring that probably isn't sufficient, I then gave it a shot of isopropyl alcohol and then used high-volume compressed air from my compressor to completely dry the components off. I cleaned the transformers with QD electronics cleaner, which is non-conductive. I set the power supply components aside while I turned my attention to the chassis and case. I used simple green and a cloth to clean everything I could reach, as well as more QD cleaner and a paintbrush for getting at some of the more delicate wiring. The fan itself was pretty caked with dirt, but it cleaned up nicely as well. With the power supply clean, dry, and ready to go back in, I started reassembly. A lot of the hardware was rusty or otherwise corroded, so I used a pair of pliers and the wire wheel of my bench grinder to polish up the screws that most needed it. They really should have been replated too, as I've now stripped them of any protective anodizing, but like I said, they were already rusty to start with, so it's not much of a loss. I removed the back plate so I could start attaching the transformers to it and be able to reach all the screws and nuts. And once all three were back in place, I reattached the backplate to the machine. Here you can see the newly cleaned up hardware, complete with the screw slots all nicely aligned. Once the transformers were back in place, it was time to make two seemingly minor, but important, repairs. There were two breaks in the transformer wiring, one at the leg of a tip transistor that was tasked with supplying a regulated 5 volts, and the other was one of the legs of the big T1 transformer where it attaches to the power supply PCB. That certainly would cause problems of some kind, but it looked like it wasn't really broken in the reference photos I had taken before I took the transformers out. Now, there's not much slack to work with there, so I might have broken it, or it might have been broken beforehand and was just being held on by the insulation. Either way, I stripped it and soldered it back onto the board where it goes. With those repairs complete, I wired the supply to the AC power cord and plugged it in so that I could check the supply voltages. And suddenly, everything was present, though a little high. Where I only had one 8-volt leg before, I now had both, and the plus minus 16 was still working as well. I'd love to tell you conclusively what it was that I fixed, but the reality is that I just don't know for 100%. Since I'm guessing there are people in the audience that know a lot more about linear power supplies than I do, I'd certainly love to hear your theories in the comments as to what the most likely cause was of the missing 8 volts. Could it have been the broken connection to the big transformer, or is the tip transistor the more likely culprit? But that's 5 volts. Or could it be something else entirely? Either way, thanks for joining me out here in the shop today. I really enjoy making these more narrowly focused videos on older tech, so if you enjoyed it, please leave a like and consider subscribing to the channel. Both help a great deal with the algorithm, and remember to turn on the bell icon if you really do want to be notified about future episodes. If you have any interest in matters related to autism, Asperger's, or ASD, please check out my book on Amazon, Secrets of the Autistic Millionaire. It has nothing to do with money and everything to do with living a successful life on the spectrum. It's everything I know now that I wish I'd known back then. Remember, I'm mostly in this for the subs and likes, so please be sure to leave me one of each before you go today. In the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage.
Do it, Glenn! Do it! Do it!